Hey guys, it's Joey from Lucas Liquors. The old man is out of town. He's actually in Kentucky right now. But I am here with Steven. He is from Crown Royal. And we're going to check out Crown Royal today.
Joey, thank you so much for having me,
of
man.
Course.
And we won't say anything about the old man being away, but we'll just kind of rub it in that we get to share some great whiskey together.
Exactly, because you told me that we got Crown 18 open.
We do. We have an open bottle. It's hidden right now behind this box. But thanks to everybody who's tuning in and checking this out. And definitely stop by. And you have such great knowledge anyway. And we're just going to give you all more knowledge today so that you can dive in.
So where are we going to start today?
You know, I wanted to start with just a little refresher because Crown Deluxe, the original Crown.
Yeah.
We all know that. That's
exactly.
A whiskey we're all familiar with.
Yeah.
One of the things I love to talk about is the process.
Okay.
How we put the blend together. Because I think sometimes with Canadian whiskey, where it's often misunderstood.
Like, yeah.
We kind of start thinking, well, what exactly is Canadian whiskey? So Canadian whiskey by law, we know it's going to be a product of Canada. It's going to be aged for a minimum of 3 years.
Okay.
It's going to be at least 40% ABV. And here's one of my favorite parts, Joe. This is actually in the Canadian whiskey parameters. It must possess the taste, character, and aroma generally attributed to Canadian whiskey.
Okay.
What does that mean? I'll wait.
What I always think of with Canadian whiskey is I always think of a little bit of a sweeter overall profile.
Yeah.
In comparison to, you know, if we compare it to bourbon or scotch, it's going to have a little bit of sweeter notes. Super, super easy to drink.
Very approachable.
Yeah, very
approachable.
Yeah.
I love that little parameter, though, because what it allows Canadian distillers to do is really experiment, right?
Yeah.
So we can do single malts. We can do blends. We can do individual grains. Everybody has their process for doing it.
Okay.
So Crown Royal has the Crown Royal way of producing, and that's just one of many ways.
Yeah.
So to give you a quick overview, Crown Royal is produced in Gimli, Manitoba. So Manitoba, right in the center of Canada.
Yep.
Gimli's about an hour or so north of Winnipeg.
Okay.
We have about 76 folks that work at the distillery. And I'll tell you, we were talking about being in the upside down for the last 2 years.
Yep.
One of the things I miss is I miss spending time with the team up there.
Yeah, being able to actually go up there and visit the distillery, talk to all the people.
One of my favorite places to visit, some incredible human beings. But at the distillery, I like to break it down to three parts. We have our distillery team, our maturation team, and our blending team.
Okay.
So the job of the distillery team is to produce all these component whiskeys that we use for our blends.
Yeah.
So we're going to take corn, rye, barley. We're going to create three unique mash bills. We're going to use multiple distillation techniques, and we're going to end up with five component whiskeys. All right? Those are going to form the foundation of what becomes Crown.
So that's all those five different whiskeys are the ones that are going to be blended to make the normal Crown.
Absolutely. But it's not just five, because we're going to take those five, and then from there, we're going to think about maturation. So we're going to put some of them in brand new wood, some of them in refill casks that have been used by us.
Okay.
And we're going to start multiplying that five out.
Okay.
So we might start with five, and then all of a sudden, the number starts to grow.
Yeah.
And then we start thinking about age and all of that.
Yeah.
Next thing you know, we have this big, I always call it a big box of building blocks for our blenders.
Yeah.
Right?
On the regular Crown Royal blend, what's the like age range itself? Is it like anywhere from that minimum to like a maximum of like 18 or?
The average age really right now, and I always say the average is probably around 8 years.
8 years? Okay.
You know, I don't like to focus on the number of whiskeys because
is
one of the master blenders who was a mentor to me always said, well, how do you count an individual whiskey? Is it an individual barrel?
Yeah.
Is it an individual style?
Mm-hmm.
So we don't want to put a number on that. But the idea is our blenders, when they take over, and again, we haven't created a blend yet, right? We're aging everything individually.
Yeah.
Then when the time is right, our blenders, okay, let's put together Crown Deluxe.
Yeah.
How do we slowly build that so the Crown Deluxe tastes like Crown Deluxe year in and year out?
Yeah.
It's that consistency,
uh-huh.
Right? It's that approachability. It's that creamy vanilla, oak, baking spice, what we expect. I always say it just kind of reaches up and caresses your cheek.
Yeah.
It's very lovely. It's very approachable.
Yes.
But that's how Crown Royal starts. So it's a really good overview, and it's a nice reminder sometimes to think about the complexity and the depth that goes into these beautiful whiskeys.
It's also one of those solid whiskeys to always have at home because of the price point.
Oh, absolutely. And plus, I love it. It's great on the rocks.
Yep.
It's great neat. It works in a cocktail.
Yeah.
You could do a Crown and cold. I mean, we even have our ready-to-drink cans that I see
kind
enough to put up there.
They,
and one of those is a Crown. Yeah,
these,
it's a whiskey.
These are awesome as well, guys. They are already canned cocktails ready to go. A lot of people have been doing them. The Crown ones are fantastic.
Which is your favorite? Can I put you on the spot?
Definitely the Whiskey Cola. Because it is just like a Crown and Coke ready to go.
I'm a peach tea guy.
Peach tea?
Just something really, especially as we're getting into a little bit of a warmer
weather.
Not that it's super warm here in Colorado right this second, but it's pleasant, it's nice.
Yeah.
But the peach tea is absolutely fantastic.
Okay.
especially as we get into the warmer months.
Yeah, so, of course.
You know, it's a little plug for that too.
Yeah.
But let's taste through a few things.
Yeah.
We're not going to taste through Crown Royal. We just want to kind of talk a little bit about it.
I've had it 100 times.
You and me both, responsibly, of course. That's always enjoy Crown responsibly. We should have said that to start.
We should have said
and,
that.
And make sure you hydrate along the way. But you and I are responsible young men, of course. I want to start with Crown Reserve.
Okay.
Because I'll tell you, when folks ask me what my favorite Crown Royal whiskey is, it's kind of like asking me my favorite niece or nephew, right?
Yeah.
I won't say, but we all have a favorite
have
niece
a favorite.
Or nephew, right? It's a given thing. Crown Reserve is my go-to.
Okay.
It's a whiskey I've loved long before I started working on Crown.
So what's special about the Crown Reserve?
So when Crown Reserve was, I'm going to pour you a little bit while we're talking about it. So when Crown Reserve was first launched in the early 90s, the idea behind this whiskey was to create kind of a thank you to folks that were already enjoying Crown.
Okay.
And our blender at the time that was responsible for this blend, he really went into the warehouses and he kind of looked at that top 1 or 2% of the barrels that were available.
Okay.
And crafted something really special, really unique.
Okay.
And then our blenders today carry on that tradition. So with this whiskey, when we look at those component whiskeys, we produce a bourbon style whiskey.
Okay.
It's Canadian, so we don't call it bourbon. It's a bourbon style.
Well, because you can't call it bourbon because you get sued over that.
Whether we people have a discussion when those things happen. But, you know, it's 2/3 corn, 1/3 rye, it's a little bit of barley. So it's a high rye bourbon if we were to make it here in Colorado, right?
Yeah.
It's the same idea. So what we're looking for is we're looking for some of those bourbon style whiskeys, the rye whiskeys that we produce.
Okay.
We produce a beautiful rye whiskey. It's 95% rye, 5% barley.
Oh, you guys,
which we'll talk
you guys
about
actually go
minutes.
Quite high on the rye then.
Oh, very high on the rye.
That
absolutely.
Is awesome.
So we're looking for some of those bourbon style and rye whiskeys that have a little bit more depth, a little bit more maturity to them.
Okay.
And then we have some of those lovely kind of corn based whiskeys that give us the creaminess, that give us that kind of butterscotch juicy fruit. So the idea is, how do we take Crown Deluxe, build upon that, and kind of create this elevated version?
Okay.
And that, to me, is what Reserve really is.
Okay.
About.
So, it's elevated Deluxe.
It's an elevated Deluxe, but now, from a blending standpoint, we don't take Deluxe and age it a little longer.
Yeah.
It's an absolutely completely separate blend, but we're pulling from some of those same building blocks.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll let you bring it up to your nose and tell the fine folks that are watching all about.
Man, that...
I will put no preconceived ideas in your head.
Yeah, but we were actually talking before. We're not really a big fan of the whole tasting notes because every single person is individual on how you smell and how you taste. And we kind of just want, you know, the consumer or anyone who's trying it to just give us your thought on exactly what you think it smells like and tastes like.
That smells really sweet off the nose right away. Kind of like a... To me, it's like honey with like maybe a little bit of an herbal overlay, kind of like a tea or something like that.
Well, like that idea.
That's at least what I'm picking up. It's kind of like that little bit of that.
I always get a lot more of the, we talk about the rye influence. We get a lot more of like that nutmeg, some of those nice baking spices
the baking
coming
spices.
Through as well.
Yeah, I guess I could classify that under like my herbal category.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, it's just a whole bunch of different type of herbs and spices.
I think spicy is always one of those things that I talk about a lot with folks, is that we think spicy, we think hot, we think peppery.
Yeah.
But we forget that when we bake, there's like nutmeg and cinnamon and cloves, and there's all these other, forms of spice.
Exactly.
Not a lot of pepper in Crown Royal. We're not going to get that.
Well, let's see what it tastes like on the palate.
Yeah, let's see. So.
Oh, man, that is beautiful. That is super, super easy to drink.
And it's unmistakably Crown too, right?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
We get all those little bursts of flavor, but then we get that beautiful, kind of rich, creamy Crown Royal finish,
which I
really love.
I love the texture of Crown Royal. I've always loved the texture of Crown Royal. As you say, it's that thicker, creamier style. I adore when any American producer has that as well. It's just that really nice, thick mouthfeel is super nice on the palate, and it like rolls back like silk. It is awesome.
That comes too from, so one of the base whiskeys we produce, one of those component whiskeys, it's actually 100% corn whiskey. We do a single distillation on column still, and then we do a second distillation on what we call a kettle column still, which looks like a kettle with a column on top. That allows us to really kind of fine tune and get the heart of the spirit. We end up with a spirit that has a very butterscotch kind of juicy fruit quality, right?
Yeah.
Very creamy.
Mm-hmm.
That shines through in all of our blends because that's what gives us that beautiful kind of coating on the inside of the mouth. Alone, it's one of my absolute favorite whiskeys, but it sacrifices itself to be part of the blend, of course.
Now, if I'm just ignoring the flavor on that, and I'm just talking about the alcohol itself is super, super, super clean. That is an amazing, just ignore the flavor.
Right.
The alcohol itself is beautiful.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's just, it's a beautiful liquid. it's a testament to our distillery team and our blending team.
Yeah.
To be able to produce that year in and year out.
Yeah.
To that high of a quality.
Also for how large a scale you guys are, because you guys are all across North America.
We are.
And you guys are also in Europe, right?
We have a little bit of play in Europe, but we're primarily North America.
Primarily?
You know, primarily North America.
Okay.
We did, we announced a few weeks ago that we have a new distillery in the works in Ontario.
Okay.
I can't give too much more insight. You could do a little search engine search, I guess. maybe a little Google search is what we would all say, right? But it's a really big thing for us. And it's going to be a while before we really make that part of the conversation.
Okay.
But I think that's going to allow us eventually, fingers crossed, to expand a little bit. But right now, I mean, I love that I get to travel all through North America.
Yeah.
You know, this is a Canadian whiskey. It was brought into the U.S. in the 60s. We saw the boom then. So there's a lot of love, a lot of rich history within the whiskey, both in Canada and the U.S.
Yeah.
So, yes, if I can start traveling throughout the world, even better.
Right?
And I'll wait. I'll wait for that. But for right now, the team at Gimli's doing an incredible job.
Yeah. What are we doing next?
Let's do a little Crown Black. I kind of want to build us up to, I'm sure we're going to taste this 18 here at the very end of things.
Of course.
But Crown Black is a unique whiskey because I always feel like it's folks who love Crown Black, they're very quick to tell you how much they love it. And I always think of Crown Black as kind of the bolder cousin of Crown Royal, if you will, right?
Okay.
Because it's just from a flavor standpoint, it's 90 proof. We're using a lot more of that bourbon style and rye whiskey in it, right? So we're getting a big punch of flavor from that.
Yeah.
A lot of new wood influence as well.
Are you using a heavier char as well in the barrel?
The char itself is just going to pretty much be the standard number 4 char.
Okay.
And that's what we do. We bring the barrels in brand new at the distillery, then we'll continue to reuse them within the distillery.
Okay.
But with this, we can actually go in and focus a little bit on a new wood.
Okay.
So that's going to give us a little bit more push on the flavor.
Yeah.
So let me pour you a little taste.
Yeah. Let's see what this guy tastes like.
This is also, I'll tell you, it's one of my favorite whiskeys for cocktails.
Okay.
Because it shines through. So, you know, a Manhattan with Crown Black, even an Old Fashioned, something that's a spirit-driven cocktail, really, really shines through quite a bit.
Yeah, and I like those spirit-driven cocktails because you're not trying to cover up the whiskey. You're just trying to, you know, add flavors around it. How
about you? You're a man. You and I are cut from the same cloth, my friend, because that's the way I look at it. When you have a good spirit, why are we hiding it?
Yeah.
We want to let it be the hero.
Exactly.
And so even when we talk about Northern Harvest Rye in a moment, it's the same idea. These whiskeys really shine through, and they are the hero of the spiritual cocktail.
It's beautiful. In all honesty, that does smell quite a bit like an American bourbon.
Mm. Like, it's got a lot of that bourbon style in there.
Yeah.
So it makes sense that you would say that.
Because it's got that kind of vanilla caramel baking spice on the nose. It literally reminds me of a bourbon.
Yeah, to me you get a lot more rich oak in there.
Yeah.
You get a lot more vanilla coming from those new barrels as well.
Yep.
And you do really, that bourbon style that we talked about, and even some of that rye whiskey that we talked about, they're really front and center. So it really starts to shine through.
Yeah.
And again, you got a little bit more proof on it, so it's got a little bit more, you know, personality in the glass, if you will.
I really like that because the rye actually didn't come off on the palate, at least to me. It didn't come off like super big baking spice, you know, cinnamon, clove, coriander, like kind of what I kind of expect from rye. It came off a little bit more how actually my favorite ryes are, which is more of that grassy, herbal kind of
a little lighter, a little softer.
Yeah, it's like that. I equate it to like playing. A handful of you have heard me with this comparison, playing Little League baseball. Being stuck out in the outfield, no kid is going to belt it out that far. So you're bored out of your mind, reach down, pick up a piece of grass and start chewing on it. It does have that kind of grassy kind of flavor to it, especially
right on
the finish.
It takes me back, man. That takes me back. I lucked out. I was a pitcher and a first baseman for the most part, so I didn't have too much downtime in the outfield early on anyway.
Yeah.
Later in life, I did become an outfielder, but balls were getting hit out there a little more frequently.
Yeah.
That just takes me back, though. Yeah, love that.
But yeah, the rye on that really did come through like that, at least to me.
Yeah, I just think it's richer, it's deeper. Again, it's unmistakably Crown Royal, right? It's pulling from those same building blocks that we talk about, but we're just getting to see different bits of that personality shine through.
That is fantastic. that's another product that's not too expensive either.
No, it's not. It's a great price point, and I know you most likely have a very good price point here at the store as well. But it's approachable, and I think that's the thing. You know, I take a lot of pride in working on Crown because I think the whiskeys are amazing.
Yeah,
there are whiskeys that are very near and dear to my heart. They're approachable, and then it's also approachable for folks to be able to come and empty up a bottle.
Yeah,
you know, to share with friends. Whiskey's meant to be shared with people.
Oh, of course.
Like, we're sharing good whiskey.
Yeah. So we're gonna do the rye next.
Let's talk a little bit about the rye.
Okay.
This whiskey excites me on a couple of different levels. One, it's an award-winning whiskey for us.
Okay.
And you may know this, 2016 was World Whiskey of the Year.
Yes.
And Jim Murray's Whiskey Bible. It was awesome for this beautiful bottle of Canadian whiskey to take front and center stage.
Yeah.
And to have everybody go, what? I want to taste that. So it really put Crown on the map again. It put Gimli on the map. Like, the folks at Gimli were just over the moon about that, of course.
So in my personal experience with just Canadian ryes in general, I have always, at least for me, noticed that when we're talking about the best ryes on the planet, they do come out of Canada. I don't know if you had any of the Alberta rye.
I have, yeah.
That is probably one of the best ryes on the planet.
There are some incredible Canadian whiskeys. We just had the Canadian Whiskey Awards back in January.
Okay.
And we were really lucky. Crown won Distillery of the Year. Our Noble Collection Winter Wheat won Canadian Whiskey of the Year. It was a big year.
That was a fantastic bottle. I have one of those at home.
Oh my goodness. Oh, and we don't use wheat, right? We're corn, rye, and barley. So the fact that we did some experiments many, many years ago and started playing with different grains or mash bills, I'm hoping we see that again down the road. No plans right now, but I mean, take off the work, had a guy can hope, right? Because it was nice. But I love the Canadian Whiskey Awards, and we had to do them virtually again this year. But I love being in the room with everybody because it's a chance to celebrate.
Yeah.
And it's a chance to see what everybody's doing.
Yeah.
And there are some incredible folks that are just so talented throughout Canada. So mm-hmm. Obviously Crown is my baby. It's right here. But Canadian whiskey is equally as important to me because of the category. I just love being a champion for the category.
Of course.
So with this whiskey, we're talking about blending again. Remember, we have that big 95% rye, 5% barley mash bill, right? So that's going to take front and center stage here. So the majority of what you're tasting is going to be that whiskey.
Okay.
But then what our blenders did, and what was just to me so creative, is they took some of those other Crown components and blended them in.
Okay.
That way it gives it that unmistakable kind of Crown personality. It meets that house style, but we're allowing that rye whiskey to take front and center stage. Something I will tell you, and maybe this is helpful for everybody tuning in too, I meet a lot of folks who are a little afraid of rye.
Yes.
There's a lot of rye whiskey out there.
Yes.
And I always tell them, take a taste of Northern Harvest rye. It's a lot different. It's a little different. It's a little more approachable than some of the more aggressive ryes.
Yeah.
And it's a great introduction, especially if it's a category you're looking to kind of explore.
And rye is one of the few categories, at least on the whiskey side, depending on where the rye is grown, completely changes the flavor.
Absolutely.
And when you harvest it, if you harvest it in the summer or the fall, depends on what you're doing with the grain, fully changes the flavor. Perfect example is Sagamore rye out of Baltimore, Maryland.
Yeah.
Dry fruits, raisins, dates.
Right.
And that's a rye.
Yeah.
And it's like, why does it have that?
It's just amazing. I get so, I'm a whiskey guy first, right? I always say I'm just a bearded guy that likes great whiskey.
Yeah.
And I get to work for this iconic brand, and I'm the luckiest guy on the face of the earth to be able to do that.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, I just love exploring. I love seeing what folks are making. What are you doing? How do you do that?
Yeah.
How do you achieve that flavor profile?
Yeah.
It's kind of like beer. Being here in Colorado, I'm a beer guy too. So probably shouldn't talk about, we'll get on a tangent if we talk about that. But I'm like, I don't have enough time in Denver to explore all these wonderful breweries.
And how many distilleries we have now.
I know. There's that too.
Yeah.
Yeah. I need to make more trips to Colorado. That's what I'm saying. Please,
yes, you do.
Please have me come back, Joe. That's all I'm
yes,
saying.
Yes, please.
So let's take a little nose and a taste.
That rye spice is perfect.
Yeah.
And it is, I would say it's on the, if we're going to like put it in the category of rye where you have like Sagamore over here with dried fruits, raisins, and dates, and you got, you know, very spicy ryes like Rittenhouse rye.
Right.
I would say that Crown Royal is going to be a little bit closer to the Rittenhouse rye side.
Yeah.
But softer.
But a little softer, right?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
A little bit prettier, a little bit softer. Super, super approachable. That is an awesome bottle.
Our blender is Joanna Scandella, who retired back earlier this year. Oh my goodness. About a year ago at this point. I forgot. I lost 2021. I think a lot of us did.
All of us did.
But she was one of our master blenders for a very, very long time. And that was, you know, her creative juices.
Okay.
You know, like she really was the driving force behind
that
original blend, and that was her baby.
Yeah. Okay.
And she's just an incredible human being. And every time I taste this, I always think of her. Yeah. I was lucky enough to spend many, many years with her, learned so much from her. But it's a testament to her, it's a testament to our distillers as well, and a testament to our blenders now to maintain that consistency of flavor that Joanna created. So
yeah.
It's absolutely lovely. And talk about a cocktail whiskey. This is a whiskey that shines through in a cocktail.
Oh yeah, that would be perfect.
Beautiful, beautiful whiskey for that. I have one more whiskey for us to try. Mm-hmm. If you don't mind.
Oh, not at all.
If that would be okay.
Especially because this is the one that I've been wanting to try ever since I saw the bottle come in. Now, I did ask you this before, and I'm going to ask it again just so our consumers can know.
Absolutely.
Is this replacing the Crown XR?
So think of it as kind of filling the void.
Okay.
So XR, just as a recap, and I know a lot of folks are super familiar with XR, we had two different versions of XR. We had our Waterloo XR, which was the red box.
Yep.
We had our LaSalle XR, which was the blue box. The history of Crown Royal, we had a lot of distilleries at one time.
Yeah.
But in the early 90s, we closed all of our distilleries except for Gimli. We pushed everything to Gimli at that point. So the Waterloo XR actually focused on the remaining whiskeys from Waterloo.
Okay.
And then the LaSalle XR, the blue box, focused on the remaining whiskeys from LaSalle. So we knew those had a shelf life, right? We knew we had just enough liquid to produce those for X number of years.
Yeah.
So the idea is the LaSalle was running out, was okay, well, do we continue the XR series? Or do we just let that sit on the shelf and say, hey, these were amazing. We're lucky we got to experience them. Let's focus on something that maybe we can make a permanent part of the family.
Yeah.
We have about 1.5 million barrels in our warehouses right now.
Really?
So we have a lot of whiskey, which is a good thing.
That's a great
thing. And we need more. So we're producing more.
Yes.
But we started looking at, well, we have a lot of really nice 18-year-old plus whiskey. How can we craft a blend around that? And our blenders went to work and tried to figure that out.
Okay.
So the youngest whiskey in this blend is 18 years. We're putting an age statement on it, which is very unique for Crown Royal.
It is very unique for Crown Royal.
And we're also looking ahead saying, okay, this is a whiskey that we can enjoy for many, many years to come.
Yeah.
So and it's guys, a really, how, really, really special.
Look how beautiful this presentation is. I know the bottle's covered up with that classic Crown Royal bag, but
we can do this, though. We can show a bottle.
Yeah, there's the bottle right there.
It's magic.
It is
TV magic, Joe.
Beautiful, beautiful presentation. I love that you guys, I mean, I think that the presentation for the brand already is already great. I think you guys did a great job with this, just presentation-wise. Let's see how the whiskey tastes.
Absolutely. Let me pour you a glass. You know, I'm always lucky. I always talk about from grain to glass, right?
Yeah.
You know, we start with quality grains. We put the grains through quality checks before we'll even bring them into the distillery.
Yeah.
But when we get to the glass portion, we get to the packaging, we have some amazing human beings that work on that as well.
Yeah.
So that we really get that grain to glass experience. Start with great grain, and then we end up with this beautiful bottle, beautiful liquid inside.
So now I've seen those YouTube videos of people throwing Crown bottles really high up in the air and letting them crash on the ground, and they just bounce off of concrete and stuff like that.
I have never done that. I treat Crown with the utmost respect. I'm all for it. Hey, if you want to do something, by all means, responsibly enjoy. But when I look at a glass of Crown Royal or a bottle, I think about the entire process. I think about everybody who's had a hand in that process.
Yeah. And is it all done in Canada, including the glass making, everything like that?
We do source. I mean, the whole entire whiskey making process takes place in Canada.
Of course.
But we will use a couple of different vendors, if you will, for different aspects of the process.
Yeah, of course.
You know, maybe we get the bottle from one place, the cap from another place.
There's
a lot of moving parts.
Of course.
But everything does get bottled in Canada, so everything ultimately ends up there.
Okay.
That's a great question. I don't think anyone's ever asked me that in all the years. And sometimes, you know, and I think it's something to point out to everybody, you know, now and then maybe you don't see something on the shelf for a little while, right?
Yeah.
It's not a liquid issue. Sometimes it's just because maybe one little piece of the, one little cog in the wheel, if you will.
The cork didn't show up.
We just needed a little extra time to get that.
Exactly.
And to make sure it meets the Crown Royal standard.
Correct.
That's always going to be front and center.
Yeah.
It has to meet our standards.
Yep. Oh.
Beautiful, right?
That is amazing on the nose. It's deep, it's rich, it is, oh my God.
To me, it's a lot of vanilla, caramel, it's light spice. It's we know it's Crown Royal, right?
Yep.
We can sense that it's got that house style, that personality.
Yep.
But it's an elevated version.
Mm-hmm. So,
let's hear.
If you are looking for a high-end bottle, that is an amazing choice. It is beautiful front to back, nice overall sweetness from front to back without being too sweet. Because I have noticed a lot of times on the older stuff when they sit that long in wood, one, they can either, you know, we can just lick this countertop right here.
The wood takes over sometimes, absolutely.
Or it's so damn sweet from sitting in that barrel, picking up any sap or anything that was left in the wood and just becoming so sweet that it's not enjoyable anymore.
Right.
That is beautiful.
It's a testament, again, it's a testament to not only our distillery team for starting that process, and our maturation team for putting, but it's a testament to our blenders.
Yeah.
For understanding and knowing what's available and being able to find that balance.
That is beautiful. I would highly recommend this bottle, guys. That is amazing.
I'll tell you, one of the things I've discovered with this whiskey, and I love pairing whiskey and food, right? We talk about pairing wine and food quite often.
I love doing whiskey.
But whiskey and food, there's so many possibilities. Break this out with some friends as the final course, maybe a dessert course, right? So we have this beautiful little glass of Crown Royal 18-year-old, but then maybe we have a little creme brulee, a little vanilla bean ice cream, maybe some dark chocolate. Possibilities are endless.
Yeah.
But the flavor is just, it's a beautiful.
It's funny because what I was actually thinking, I was thinking actually, if you do like, what I like to pair a lot of whiskeys with is actually a lot of the smoked meats.
Oh.
Because you take a sip of the whiskey, let it rest on the palate, and then have a piece of meat. And then just keep interchanging that.
You know what would be good for that is the
black.
Black.
The black would be fantastic.
Brown black, 100%.
But this with some smoked brisket and a little bit of barbecue sauce, I think would actually be fantastic.
I think that's something everybody should try.
Yeah.
We need to have a little barbecue here.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll do a little parking lot barbecue. I don't know. I love the idea.
This is amazing. Thank you for coming out. I really appreciate it.
It's an absolute pleasure. You know, for me, this is what it's all about, right? Meeting a new friend, sharing good whiskey, meeting some new friends virtually as well.
Yeah.
And all of us just having a great experience together. So I appreciate you having me stop by. And it's just an awesome way to spend our day together.
Of course. And as we always say, guys, thank you for shopping with us. Have a wonderful day. Make sure to like and subscribe. See ya.